cleansed us. And Father, the great love that we're singing about this morning, my prayer is that we'd get a revelation of that love. And then, Father, you would encourage us and equip us to walk in it. So, Father, we praise you and we thank you. We thank you, Father, that you bring the promise of God by faith to us. I thank you, Father, this morning that even when things look dim and dark, you bring light and life to us. I thank you, Father, that whenever the Word becomes alive inside of us and we get out of our religious rigors and we get in true relationship with you, Father, our whole lives change. I pray, Father, that you would strengthen this church, that we could stand upright and we could walk the way you called us to walk, that we can have impact throughout this mountain region, this state, and this nation. And as far reaching as you send us. So, Father, I give you praise and I give you thanksgiving today, knowing how wretched we were, but how right we are now because of the righteousness of God. Father, I praise you and I thank you for the encouragement that you give us in John 3:16. God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world that he gave up his only begotten Son so that whoever believes in and trusts in and clings to and relies on him shall not perish or come to destruction or be lost. But you have provided eternal, everlasting life. For God did not send the Son into the world in order to judge, to reject, to condemn, or to pass sentence on the world, but that the world might find salvation and be made safe and sound through him. He who believes in him and on him is not judged. He who trusts in him never comes up for judgment. For him there is no rejection, no condemnation. He incurs no damnation. But he who does not believe and who does not trust in him is judged already. He has already been convicted and already received his sentence because he has not believed and trusted in the name of the only begotten Son of God. But he who does shall be delivered and set free and have everlasting life. Amen? I'm telling you, this morning the love of the living God is so real. If we could gain revelation of that love, we would be so much better off. We'd never have a worry. We'd never have any kind of anxiety. We'd never have a fear not getting what we thought belongs to us. You know why? Because the love of God takes no account of a wrong done to it. The love of God endures everything. It stands the test of time. The love of God will get you all the way through eternity if you'll trust in him. For God is love. Amen? Turn to someone and tell you love them in the name of the Lord. It's so good to have you this morning. Praise the Lord. Hi, baby. I love you. You know, it's amazing, the love of God. Chris Cato gave me a bookmark some time back about the Holy Ghost. And this would be the command of the Lord. According to Acts 1, 4 and 5, Jesus commanded. He didn't ask them if they had time. He didn't ask them what they thought about it. He didn't ask them to be nice now and going up there. Jesus commanded his disciples not to leave Jerusalem until they were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Did you know that? And Jesus told his disciples they would receive power to witness all over the world after the Holy Ghost had came upon them, according to Acts 1 and 8. And did you also know that on the day of Pentecost, the believers were all filled, all. Everybody say everybody. Everybody. With the Holy Ghost and begin to speak with other tongues, according to Acts 2, 1 through 4. And did you know that he said in John 14, he said, it's the Comforter who will guide us into all truth, according to John 15 through 18. It's the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, that's going to guide us into all truth. Did you know that? It's the Comforter who will teach us all things, remind us of every word that Jesus ever said when we need it, according to John 14, 26. And did you know that it's a Holy Ghost is going to help us out in every situation. According to Romans 8, he helps us when we are distressed and don't know how to pray. According to Romans 8 and 26, he said, when you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, you don't know what to pray for, he will pray through you. In John 7, 38 and 39, he's like a river. The Holy Spirit is like a river of living water flowing out of believers to a lost and dying world. So the command is today is just stay in this building right here until you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, because you're going to receive power to go to the next level. You're going to receive the Comforter. You're going to receive the Teacher this morning, and he is going to bring you to a new understanding and a new presence of God and power to change men and women's lives. Amen. Starting with ours. Amen. So turn to somebody and say, I want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And I want a fresh anointing this morning for those that's already been baptized in the Holy Ghost. That this is a great awakening. We're entering in and are in the end times of God. We know that. I mean, I'm going to share some things with you this morning. It's going to be very good. I know, because it's right out of the Word of God. And I don't know, I'll probably allude to it. I listened a little bit to our president talk about how committed he was to Israel. And that's going to fit right into my message. And so, anyway, God is so good, isn't he? All the time. Hey, y'all know this is Debt Demolition Sunday. I hope all of you brought 5 extra checks to it. You got them? This is that, Faye, isn't it? You're the one that coined the word. It's, I got mine and my wife's. Everybody, I mean, we are on a mission. Everybody say Blues Brothers. We're on a mission for God, man. Did y'all not see that? Oh, anyway, somebody laugh. I mean, it was bad enough last week whenever we was talking about Abraham and Sarah, and I said I was going to lay hands on my wife, and everybody booed me. And I went on right back with Abraham, and I said, well, I staggered not at the boos of the church. I just kept on giving praise to God and gaining strength as I walked with God. Amen? Oh, man. Y'all don't know how to take it, do you? Praise the Lord. God is good. Yeah, just a test. Praise the Lord. Just a test. Just a test. You know, if you're gaining the Word of God on a daily basis, you'll have a test daily. Because it said when the sower sows the Word, immediately Satan comes to try to steal it out of your heart before it ever gets planted and rooted in there. So the test will come. And what does the test produce? Moanies. Testimonies. The test produces moanies. Everybody say the test produces moanies. I have a testimony this morning, you see. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. God is good all the time. Praise God. Well, are y'all, we made it to Texas and back. We got, we had the grace of God with us. It was so good. The Holy Spirit directed us. You know, Mother's 91. She needed her own place to live. She's lived with my sister 4 years. And really with Mother, she wants to talk, be up, moving 24/7 nearly. And for one person, it wears them out. And then all of a sudden, Charlotte caught her going to the neighbors, and she didn't know which neighbors, so she had to hunt her down and bring her back home. So we went to Texas last week, prayed, and looked at several different facilities, and I'm telling you, God is so faithful. We found a place through the direction of the Holy Spirit that's one of the nice. I wouldn't mind. I told Patricia, why don't we move in here? It was so nice. She has her own apartment. She has friends. There's a beauty shop, Miss Shaw, right in the facility. There's people and they exercise every morning. They have church 4 times a week. They have all kinds of stuff, and she loves it. And we got her signed in on Wednesday, and she's doing wonderful, and she enjoys it. And my sister has a break now, and so. You know, it's wonderful. I never thought that she would move in back by herself. But you know what? I think she loves it. And I think she loves having her own place in there. And they have 24-hour care. It really worked out beautiful. So I thank the Lord for that and for y'all's prayers concerning my mother, because she is one of the most wonderful people on the face of the earth as far as I'm concerned. So God is good, and He is faithful to His Word. Well, everybody is happy. Everybody ready to sow today? We're going to sow into the kingdom of God. We're believing for your debt to be demolished. We're believing that this is going to be and will be, and by faith is, the first group of men and women that is totally debt-free, 100%. And as a result, the ministry is debt-free, 100%. Amen? So will y'all believe with me this morning as we sow our seed into the kingdom of God? Remember, we're sowing into the kingdom, investing in the earth. God will open up opportunities for you to invest, and He'll guide your steps, and it'll develop properly. Amen? Are y'all ready? Okay, well, let's make our declaration. Y'all lift your seed up to the Lord. As we give today's offering, we're believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs, businesses and better business, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and return, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money and bills paid off, and debts demolished, royalties received, supernatural increase on investments made, and souls for our inheritance. It's offering time. Hallelujah. We'll do two. Yeah, y'all just wait up here. Through you. y'all hear me? Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. For brother, everybody give Brother Mark a hand. His faithfulness has stretched over 2 decades. I know he doesn't look that old. No. But praise God. I thank Brother Mark for his service to the kingdom. Okay, for all you folks that don't know this scripture, I'm going to read it to you because money's a funny thing. And Satan's tried to pervert it in the minds of the church. And it's going to take money to pay our debt off and your debts. So let me read this to you. I think it's so good. This is Ecclesiastes 10 and 19. A feast is made for laughter. Everybody laugh. And wine maketh merry. Everybody be merry. But money answereth all things. Do y'all know I'm reading out of the Bible? I didn't write it. Let me read that again to you. For some of you real religious folks. Now listen. A feast is made for laughter. And wine maketh merry. This is an actual quote. This is Ecclesiastes 10 and 19. But money answereth all things. You know what I found out? I just drove to Texas and back last week. Without money, I'd have walked. And without money, I would have been stopping on the way, working my way back, because I would have been working for some money to get back. Or I'd still be in Texas. That's right. Thank you, Dewey, for that. I just thought I'd read that to you before we sew in for debt demolition. There's 2 ways to receive finance. The world's way, where it's based on sometimes greed, which got us into the condition we're in. Sometimes it's based on, well, just different things. Sometimes it's based on good business practice. But God's way of blessing you is obedience. That if he says, if you will prove me with your tithes and offerings, I will bless you beyond measure. I will open the windows of heaven out. I will pour you out a blessing you cannot contain. I will cause men to give into your bosom. I will cause supernatural increase to come to you. I will give you wisdom to profit that the gospel might go around the world. That's God's way of doing things. And when you're challenged as a church to do it God's way instead of the world's way, a conflict comes. Old training, old fears come up, different things come up. But I will guarantee you this, most of you in this congregation have learned, when you get rid of the fear and cast it aside and begin to do it God's way, then God's provision shows up. Does it not? Amen. Amen. So I encourage you to do it God's way. And when you do, I will tell you this. God said, I won't let the pastor be put to shame because I will perform the word in their behalf. Amen? Amen. So, are y'all ready to sow into the kingdom? Yes, sir. This is what I see. I see every family that walks in obedience to God according to their giving, their sowing. I don't care if you can only sow pennies this morning. If you'll do it with the right heart, you'll be on the right road. I see you debt free. I see the provision of God supernaturally coming in different ways that then you can be a catalyst God can use to help others. And the gospel will go far as God wants us to take it, whether it's Sholo or whether it's Belgium, India. It doesn't make any difference. He will make the provision, and He makes it supernaturally through opportunity in Jesus' name. Amen? So everybody say, by faith, I'm debt free. I receive provision to get the gospel out. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's bring it on up. We're going to demolish that debt right now, Brother Clark. Here you go. Ecclesiastes 10 and 19. Said you had a word you wanted to speak, Gloria. Well, you're so close together, you look just alike. Hold on just a second. Hold on a second. Y'all just stand there and
look.
Is this on? Okay. Gloria.
Yeah.
Isn't God good?
God, didn't you?
Amen. I hear from him every now and then.
Yeah. Good morning. I have good news, bad news. Well, it came to me this week. I lost my dog of 11 years, my buddy, my bed partner. God gave her to me when my husband died, and she has been the perfect companion all these years. So she had a really bad liver disease, and finally I could see she was starting pain. So I knew it was time. So Thursday, Glenda took me and her to the vet, and we put her down. All right, good news. The buyer of my trailer came by with $1,700, which leaves a flat $10,000 to pay off the trailer. That $10,000 will pay off Home Depot, praise God.
Amen.
So, with that, I am giving my tithe to God, and you distribute it wherever you feel is necessary. There's $1,300.
Praise God. Okay. I don't ever tell anybody our financial situation because we walk and talk and speak faith. So if we're believing God by faith, then you don't need to know if it's already manifested or we've already believed and it's in the spirit realm. And I do call us blessed, over the top, all of us millionaires as far as the world sees us. But we were believing this morning for a super abundant, over the top offering. And because Believe it or not, up here on this mountain, some of y'all live here, don't you? It's a walk of faith to go from one week to the next. And so we need God supernaturally to infuse you with finance. And then when he does, don't forget where it come from. And I'm telling you, I thank God. I believe God for the hundredfold return on this according to the word of the living God. It says if you give houses and homes and for the gospel's sake, that he'll bless you a hundredfold, Gloria, in this lifetime. And I believe that in Jesus' name. Donna wanted to have one quick word and make it a quick one. Donna, I've got a lot to say this morning. Can we go over noon? Hey, I want y'all to give her a hand. Now turn around here. Face this congregation. Look how healthy, good, and beautiful this woman is. And we is all praying for you, Donna.
And I thank God that you were. I had a living mass that came up in 4 months and was invading my lung and was cancerous. And I am cancer-free.
Amen. I love you, Donna. I love you, Donna. Yeah, you can go. I was going to say something, but I thought I better not. I went over a couple of things. By the way, guys, y'all are missing some of the greatest times on Saturday morning. We had a great breakfast yesterday morning, and God also always inspires us to share the word of the living God in a special way. And all the kids can go at this time. And we had a great time. And I tell you what, the biscuits and gravy are great. And I went over some things and with our people. I just want to quickly go over this, because a lot of people come up, how do I become a member of the New Living Church? And how am I a part? We don't have official membership, because we feel like that's between, you know, you and God, and if you feel connected to this body, what gets me is I want you to understand, when God brings you here, it's not for you to just be able to come on Sunday morning and maybe every now and then on Wednesday night. It's to be involved in kingdom work through the men and women that are here, that we can reach outside these four walls and affect this area and this nation. And so if you want to be part of this church, I want to read off. I've got four things here we've done. I want you to make a commitment. I'm not going to ask you to sign it, but all of our leaders have to sign it. But I want you to understand this. And on Saturday morning, throughout all the month of March, we're going to meet. Men and women are coming together. We'll meet up in Fellowship Hall, and we're going to encourage one another along the line in what God's doing in and through this church and what our vision is in the coming year. 2012 is a year of miracles. And when I say that, I'm not talking about just healing. I'm talking about tremendous restoration, recovery, God restoring passion and vision to men and women that need it to go forward. Amen? So one of the things I want to read to you, one of the things and one of the ways to be part of this church, a lot of people just focus on themselves. What we got to do is focus on God and the will of God. And what is our part? Who do we, you know, and then as the pastor, after you make the commitment, I will do my best to hold you accountable to your word. Amen? So, one of the ways to be part of this church is you need to make the commitment. I will protect the unity of my church. I will protect the unity of the church. And how do we do that? by acting in love toward other members. Quit just being so full of yourself you can't love somebody. Y'all all know me pretty good by now. But listen, this is important because we're in a season. I've had several prophecies. God gave me a dream over a week ago. This place is fixing to explode with men and women to do the work of the ministry. God gave me an open dream, a vision. It was so real. Every seat, and we had a lot more seats in here than we've got now. I'm going to have to buy more chairs. Was totally packed with men and women hungering for God and hungering to do the work of God. And I know it'll come to pass. And one of the next things to protect the unity of the church is refuse to gossip. Amen? The next thing is that you've got to be in agreement and unity to follow the leadership. And I try to lead by example, guys, in this church. We've got other leaders we've got in this church, and we've got Bud and Ruth Brown, who set a tremendous example. I mean, they set a tremendous example to help me. We've got Clark and Mary, Dennis, Jolene, Bruce and Jeanette. We got all kinds out here that set a good example. And they do not cross me very often. I'll tell you what they do. I'm not one that runs something with my thumb on everything, but we have such a mutual respect for one another. If they're going to do something, they always come and talk to me about it. And I respect that because really and truly, I mean, just like Wednesday night, Brother Bud said, I feel led that we should show the movie Courageous. He's a leader. I said, I believe from what I've heard about that movie, it tells such a story that if everyone would come, they would be blessed and they would receive something. Well, everybody didn't come, so that shows a lack of being willing to think the leadership is guiding you right. See, you understand what? That's how I see it. You said that you don't want to go waste your time watching a movie. I see it that God put that movie together to speak to men and women. I mean, I had someone tell me this morning because of that movie, this week after the movie on Thursday, they made a life-changing decision that will affect their life from now on. They told me that this morning. And I'm telling you, sometimes you don't may not understand why we do certain things, but if you're called here of God, and we're not asking you to do something ungodly, you're part of the family. Let's get involved, okay? Number two, one of the things that we need to do to be part of the church is I will share the responsibility of my church. And A under that is by praying for its health and growth. We need to be praying daily for the growth of the church. Why? It's not because we need the church to grow. It's because this area needs a strong voice given by God to affect the lost, those that are misunderstood, those that are hurt, those that are sick. And the more men and women we got that will pray for the health and the growth of the church, then the more and further out we're going to get more people we can reach for Christ. Amen? Number two. Sharing the responsibility by inviting the unchurched to attend. You got to believe it. See, I believe in what I'm doing enough. Do you do that? Good. Everybody needs to do that, but you need to believe that you're getting the spiritual food you're supposed to get, you're getting the encouragement you're supposed to get. I exhort you to stand up and be men and women of God, and that you're the hands and feet of God and you represent God on this mountain, and you got to believe it enough to bring men and women here to receive the same word. Amen? Okay. And then when you get here and you see people come in, we need to warmly welcome everyone who is a guest. Do we have any guests this morning? We got two right here. We need to warmly welcome them. We got guests right here. We need to make sure they know whether they ever come again. If they're passing through town, they've had an encounter with men and women that have Almighty God flowing through their veins. Amen? Number three, and their brains. Number three, we need to say, if you want to be part of the church, I will serve in the ministry of my church. You understand what I'm saying? It's not just about coming and going. It's about service, guys. And how do we serve the church? First of all, you get in your prayer closet, you begin to pray, and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal your gifts and callings on your life so that it can be developed and released in this church so that we can affect the lost and dying outside the walls. Amen? Number two, by being equipped to serve alongside my pastors. You see, you got to be willing to serve alongside with the leadership of God put here. I think now it's got to be proven, August 1 to be 8 years, that God brought Patricia and I here. God brought us here to have an impact on a very hard area, to bring the softness, the love, the development of God in there. You say, well, you're pretty hard. Sometimes you got to be pretty straight and firm to break through the outer crust to get to the meat of a matter so that the goodness of God can flow. Amen? So you need to be willing to work alongside of your pastors. And then number C under three, if you want to serve in the ministry, you got to develop a servant's heart. If you think it's all about you, you'll never aspire in the kingdom of God. I believe Patricia and I serve from the bottom up. We do our best to put everything we can into this ministry to make sure that we don't ever mince words, that we don't just speak under the oracles of man, but under the oracles of God, that we put our life in our finance, our will, our passion to develop men and women to fulfill their destinies in God. Amen? And so we need to all develop a servant's heart. What can I do to serve others? Because God will bless you with it if you do. Okay, four. I will support the testimony of my church. Yeah, this church has a tremendous testimony. Two or three times it could have evaporated and gone because the enemy tried to destroy it. But God had a better reason. The testimony is this. It's the strongest, most word-centered, spirit-filled church in the region. That's the testimony of it. More people get healed walking in these aisles and this zone of healing than anywhere I've ever known. I mean, it's so commonplace, people don't even hardly talk about it. And I'm talking about things that where people wasn't supposed to live, they're living totally free of cancer, heart disease, hepatitis, all the other things are eradicated through the anointing and the power of God. Why? Because we believe it. And we present it as truth. So we need to support the testimony of the church. What is a testimony? It's a full gospel church. It's a word-based church. We believe in walking by faith. And yes, we believe that we make declarations, and that declaration excites faith on the inside of us. And as a result, God gets glory because fruit begins to be produced out of our lives. Amen? And the first thing under supporting the testimony of the church is by attending and participating faithfully. And the hush fell over the group. So many folks don't realize, because we probably have not really emphasized it the way we should have, is it's not just about coming and receiving the word. It's not just about coming and getting what you can get. It's about coming and creating an excitement about the things of God and showing up and being at functions so that you can share in it and you can give your part to it. That is so important, especially for new believers coming in to see us joined together in a faithful situation. Amen? And be under number four by living a godly life. You say, how do I do that? By the power and presence of the Holy Ghost. You can't do it in your flesh. What is a godly life? Well, a godly life, I believe, is lining up with the Word of God. Choosing to do God's will over your own will. We've looked at godly life in the wrong way. We've always based it on just natural things. It goes much deeper than that. What does your spirit transmit when you're in a group? What do people see when you're around? Do they sense the peace of God? I'm telling you, God wants His presence to begin to illuminate and come forth out of us like never before. Amen? And so, and the last but not least, if you want to support the testimony of the church, it's by giving regularly. I heard Benny Hinn say, and I've made this statement, I couldn't believe he said it, he said he just would give emotionally when he was young in the ministry. And God said, that ain't a me. Give because the Word says it, and walk in obedience to the giving, and then I can honor that. And I can remove the spirit of mammon off of your money. I can make it go further. I'll open up doors for you, and I will show you, don't give emotionally. Give because you know it's a heart thing, and the Word of God is saying it, and it's a heart thing. You hear me? And it'll work for you then. Amen? Praise the Lord. And so, we will see that this year is going to be the greatest year of our life as a church, as individuals, because we make decisions to walk upright before God and walk in obedience to what we've heard and what we know. Amen? God is good all the time. Amen? Praise the Lord. Well, it's only 11:20. I've got time to give a 20-minute sermon, don't I? I'll give three of them. I'm going to tell you something. Thank you for that. I've been thinking about everybody wants to feel that they have success. Every human being has a need to understand that they have been created to be successful in whatever realm or whatever calling they have. And I begin to think and I begin to look, and it really was accentuated this morning when I listened to President Obama speak, but if you want to have success with God, you must learn how to walk in integrity from your heart. God said, I am a God that changeth not. I will be forever the same. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. And I change not. I will not allow one word of this covenant to drop to the ground. I see that it is not changed, and I will perform it in your behalf. But we need to learn. I told the group yesterday, I think I'm going to just preach out of Ephesians 5. Be imitators of God. Everybody say, I'm going to imitate God today. You see, to be imitators of God, you got to stand up and believe what you say and say what you believe. He had no qualms about speaking light into this earth. It was full of darkness. Darkness was overshadowing everything. It had no form, but it did not disrupt God's thinking. It did not make him wonder if he spoke anything would happen. He just spoke light into existence and it happened. So we can believe in his word and we can believe in God as a God of integrity. I mean, after working so many years, we've pioneered churches for 30 some odd years, and there's only been two that we took that was already existing, the one in Hilton, Oklahoma, and this one. The rest, God would take us to a place and would start from scratch. And the reason that I felt God wanted us to do that, I didn't want to mess with the old mess. I wanted to start my own mess. Amen? So, and God honored that. We started a lot of messes. So, anyway, what I'm saying is this. We need to understand the height of things with God is integrity. That if you say something, you do it. The Bible says that if you say something and you know you put your foot in your mouth, he said you swear to your own hurt and do it anyway and don't make an excuse to crawl out of it. Isn't that good, Dewey? It's a good business practice. Amen? So I want us to, Psalms 25 and 21 says, let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for and expect you, Lord. So integrity will preserve you, and in your walk with God and walk of faith and perseverance, you can expect God to come on the scene. Amen? Do you know, let me give you a definition of what integrity means. It means consistency of actions, consistency of values, methods. We don't just shift our method and get an ungodly method to try to achieve a godly outcome. You can't do that. It goes against your integrity. It goes against your values. It will not work, and eventually it will kill you. When you try to live a life that's different from the values that you really have, it will bring you down, it will destroy you, and take you to the side. But integrity means your values, your methods, and what you measure things by. Integrity means this. Integrity means that you have principles you live by. Integrity, what are your expectations? And your integrity will hold you so you will have a good outcome. Integrity is regarded as the honesty and truthfulness or accuracy of one's actions. You know, we always hear about hypocrites in the church. You don't have to be in the church to be a hypocrite. You can be a very successful businessman running some office up the street. And you may present one thing in your words, and you may act another way, and your values have been violated, so you have no integrity, and so you're a hypocrite. Amen? As I was listening to President Obama this morning, FLAMUSING, or whatever you call it, the American-Israel PAC, the biggest group of Jews in America, and he was addressing them this morning, and he was talking about everything he's done for Israel. He was talking about he was the best president that Israel's ever had. He said that. He said, there ain't no president ever done more for Israel than I have. And as far as I'm concerned, there's no president that's put Israel under the bus more than he has. But what I was thinking about, because I was reading, and I thought I wanted to see this, because I wanted to see what he was saying. What are you saying? Is your life corresponding with what you say? Or when you're just in front of the group, do you say one thing, but you don't have intentions of following through with it? And I thought about our president, and I thought about, you know, he's meeting tomorrow with Netanyahu, or whatever his name is. And how do you pronounce it? Not Netanyahu. I like that guy. I pray for him all this week. I was praying, Lord God, strengthen him that he'll make a godly decision. He won't back up if the whole world's facing him down. Let him stand up in your power. And so he was talking, and it really fed into what I wanted to get over to men and women here. We need to be men and women known of integrity. If you want to succeed with God, you've got to have integrity, and you can't be one way here and another way when you get home. Amen? Do you hear me? So what I want you to understand, that let integrity and uprightness preserve you, And as you wait before the kingdom of God, the throne of God, you can expect great and mighty things to be unfolded to you because of your integrity and your faith in God. Integrity will preserve you in your walk on a daily basis. It will take you to new levels of understanding. It will open doors that you never thought would open because the people that are observing you will want to know you and be with you because of integrity. Amen? So, integrity demands excellence. I remember when I first came up here and was building this building and we was doing other things, and man, it was hard to find anybody that would work over 2 days a week. I mean, man alive, I thought, we'll hire some people, we'll do the thing, they'll show up Tuesday and Wednesday, but they're getting ready to do something else Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And they don't have that much money, but yet they won't work. Their work ethic, their integrity to their word when you hire them is no good. You've got to have integrity in your walk before the world because God wants to give you favor before God and man. And your integrity makes all the difference in the world. Amen? So, integrity demands excellence. If you tell a man that you're going to do something, then do it. Don't come to me. If you tell me I'm going to do this, and then all of a sudden, when the time comes to do it, something else has come up more important, hogwash. Let the president wait. I'm just trying to get you to where you're very successful in the kingdom of God. For integrity means so much, especially in a world that has very little. Very little. Integrity is simply the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? We need to understand that we operate on the word of the living God. And I will say this, the only way you'll ever walk in true integrity is be a man or woman that's a word woman or a word man seeking the heart of God, for you won't have the strength to do it otherwise. Amen? So I encourage you this morning to understand that integrity demands quality of life, quality in how you present yourself. When I came here, and don't anybody get offended at this, you can come here, the craze now is be sloppy and junky and as ugly as you can be. And well, a lot of the big churches, they come out. I got a friend, he wants to preach in Bermuda shorts, old t-shirt, because he don't like how his daddy preached. That has no bearing on it. But what I'm saying is this. If you're going to walk in integrity. I mean, JR even looked good this morning. And by the way, Kelly, it's so good to have you home. Taking care of her mother that fell and got hurt, been gone 3 months. I thought you'd raptured and I'd got left behind. Let me encourage you a little bit. And don't get mad at me. It's just an observation. If you're a man or woman of God in high esteem, don't you think you need to wear the nicest robe? Don't you think you need to set the example for those that are less fortunate? I mean, to be honest with you, I don't know how I got off on this, but just to be honest with you, you would probably come if I wore my work jeans, get holes in them. I noticed the other day I had a pair on, I spilled battery acid on. There's a hole here and some down here. Did you see that? Got holes all in them and everything. You'd probably come. But inside, because of the way I was trained, Inside, because I'm coming to represent the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Because I'm coming and I represent a kingdom that's not only here but one in heaven, that they actually pave their streets with gold because nothing else is good enough. And you know why he's doing that? He's getting ready for you to drive on them and to walk on them. And he's saying this: if I can get you to a place of integrity, if I can get you to buy into the value of being the best, looking the best, acting the best, being consistent in your quality, going beyond the call of duty, coming to a new place, I think it makes all the difference in the world. You know why I think there's so much rebellion in the church? Because everybody wants to look sloppy and ugly and nasty. And whenever you do that, you're sloppy, ugly, nasty. It breeds, and that is brought on by a spirit.
Amen. Yes.
I've been in many insane asylums, but I got out last time, didn't have to go back. I've been in a lot of mental institutions, casting demons out of men and women, young men and women. I can remember Gary Jones' brother. He was so demon-possessed, I had to go in there and dodge. He'd be throwing stuff at me out of the commode and stuff, and totally eat up with demons. And let me tell you this. Everywhere there is demon activity to a level that makes you dirty, you will be dirty. I bet my wife's saying, why don't you be quiet? I'm telling you, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, if we're representing God, why don't we do it the way we should? You say, well, God don't care. Oh, I think he cares a lot. I think he cares how you look. Zig Ziglar teaches on motivation all the time, and I had a motivational company in England too. That's how I got the door open to all these solicitors and all these CEOs. And I'd use biblical principles. And somebody stood up in the audience and said, "Well, Zig, motivation doesn't last." He said, "Well, a bath don't either. But if you don't take one, nobody will want to be around you very long."
That's true. What'd you look at me for?
I'm sorry. What I'm saying is this. Why don't we get the idea of who we really are? Why don't we understand that we're children of the living God? We're no longer in the past under the thumbprint of Satan. We have been lifted up by the Son of His great love, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Why don't we take on? I will guarantee you this. If any one of you went to work for a Fortune 500 company, you was working up top, you was drawing $500 to $1 million a year, when you come in to address everybody else and you represent that company, you will come in dressed to the T. Why? It's not because the company thinks that you're any less of a person, it's what you project when you come in. We need not only project from the inward man, but we also need to project the outward man, that the inward man has changed the outward man.
Amen.
Amen? So what I'm saying is this. When we used to have, and I'm not knocking it, grumpy, grubby Sunday. Well, we did, didn't you? Grubby Sunday. We'd dress as ugly and as dirty as we could on the fifth Sunday of a month. And I thought, of course, I'm from a different place. I said, there ain't no way we're ever going to have another grubby Sunday here. See how nice y'all look now? Turn to somebody and say, you look awful nice. See, one man's best may not be another man's best. One man's best may be a clean pair of jeans, a pullover shirt, a pair of tennis shoes. That may be his best. Another man's best may be a nice suit, tie, whatever. And a lot of people say, I ain't wearing no suit and tie no more. Well, I've said that myself. I wear Tommy Bahama shirts in the summer. But you say, what does this have to do with integrity? I will say this. Men and women that get on fire for God and dig in the Word of the living God, and they begin to be transformed like never before, and some pastor or leader teaches and encourages them that it's not up to them how they look. It's up to this scripture, and we're to look the best, we're to be the best, and we're to be the most solid that anybody could ever be, and we need to encourage our young people. When the old people dress like the young people, how are they going to shoot at something? They need to be shooting at how we look, how we dress, and how we act. Amen. It all develops young people. It's all a development. It's all a training program. We're all being developed to do the work of the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll tell you what, when Obama comes out, and he's just the president of the United States, I hardly ever have seen him ever without a suit and tie on. Have y'all? And the reason I'm saying this, why am I on this? He knows who he represents. Do you? The Bible in 2 Corinthians 5 calls you an ambassador to the greatest kingdom that ever existed. He calls you a personal representative to the greatest king that ever was. He calls you, men and women, you need to look at yourself and get that inner self to begin to come alive and know that you're serving the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. I mean, I'm getting my hair cut off again. Well, I don't like to, if I'm in a hurry, I don't like my hair laying sideways. I told my wife, I said, it'll take one of the best pair of tweezers ever made to grab my hair. It's going to be so sharp. I'm just teasing, do y'all understand, if we don't watch it, we get in a rut and we think things are one way, and really God's saying, I want integrity. I want the best. I want you to produce fruit. I want you to look, smell, act, and most of all, let the inside affect the outside. You understand me? So integrity is a lot of things. It demands quality. We got to be the same behind the curtain as in front of the curtain. Amen? That's been a big problem sometimes. Denying sometimes, you've got to deny yourself if necessary. But remember, Ephesians 6 says this. Knowing if whatever good anyone does, the Lord repays. Yes, ma'am. Okay, now let me ask the question. You really puzzle me. First of all, just speaking up like that.
I'm sorry, forgive me.
And I'm just teasing. What I want to say, I'm glad you said that, because I want to make a point here. Who did you go to?
The Optimist Club.
The what?
Optimist.
What does that mean, optimist?
It's a club.
No, what does optimist mean? Opposite of pessimist.
Yes.
It means they're optimistic about life and children. It means that she didn't go to another agency that had no money. She went somewhere that had money, because money had an answer to feed these kids.
Amen.
Oh.
And so in my class, children and we have late starts and they have no breakfast, we can feed them. And that's Amen. What you all need in this church is an optimistic, yes, and forgive me, sometimes I am here, but I work on the outside. And I work for the poor.
Yeah, but the thing about it is,
you're my church.
Cindy, everybody is supposed to be trained to work on the outside.
Well,
what work's done in here is develop the men and women to walk in integrity, to learn how to prosper, be in health, let their mind not play tricks on them, and go forward, because God wants us to affect society. Hey, amen. I don't doubt that a bit. Hey, listen, what I'm saying here, maybe we need to change our view.
Amen.
It doesn't make any difference where you're at on the social level. It doesn't make any difference where you're at on the economic level. What makes a difference is what are you going to believe and where are we going to go? Because you've got a future ahead of you, a future. You got one that's good. And God's not against you. He wants to accelerate you and lift you up and let that integrity that's really in your heart begin to manifest in every area so that He can bless you and you can be a blessing everywhere you go. You see, I got cussed out Tuesday or Wednesday. It was a good cussing. A guy knew how to cuss. He used words that I hadn't heard in a long time. It was so good. And it was about getting off his porch. Well, the neighbor of this house I'm selling has, first of all, the most ungodly colored house I've ever seen. And also, he's building lean-tos and putting folks up in these lean-tos in the backyard. And I just went over to him and I said, "Look, Jose, I said, I will be willing to pay for half the materials if we can get a fence up and cover up." I said, "It looks like you're under construction." He said, "Are you prejudiced?" I said, "No, do you think all Hispanics act like that?" He was a prejudiced one. I wasn't prejudiced at all. I'm trying to sell my house. I'm willing to pay money. I'm willing to help him get his yard fixed up. I'm putting a 6-foot stockade fence up. He used words like I can't mention. My wife said, "You made him awful mad. Didn't you know how to handle him?" I said, "No, I didn't." And so what I did, I turned around, walked off, went and got my worker, went down, and he had half the fence finished. And I wanted to pay to get the other half finished. And there's a chain link fence between them. I just went down, bought enough panels, got my worker to go out there and just put it up on my side and go down a full panel on the other side, and I covered it up anyway. But it would have looked nicer if he had probably let me put it on his side. But what I'm saying, what am I saying? What I'm saying is this. I would be the same way no matter who it was. I first had a thought, I'm going to go turn him into the city. Because I knew he had no permits. I knew he was building a commune in the backyard. And I knew that he didn't know the Lord by the way he talked. And then I began to have compassion and I said, "No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go just build that fence, put it on my side, and I'm going to act like a Christian." And I did that. And then when I'm in town again, I'm going to go over and apologize for upsetting him and if I did anything to upset him. You say, "Well, why would you do that? What, it wasn't your fault." Well, it don't make any difference whose fault it is. We're to reach people. We're to reach the lost. It don't cost us anymore. Integrity has to be there. How do you act? How do you respond? Sure, you might lose it for a second, but I'm sure after this message, You're going to come back and act like Jesus would act. You're going to be imitators of God. Whenever they spit in his face, he still died for them. And you understand, don't let me say something that gets you off the central core of this. Don't get mad at me because I want you to dress different. Don't get mad at me because I want you to hear what I'm saying. Make a decision to live your life consistently in line with the Word of the living God, and let the Holy Spirit inside of you prompt you, encourage you to walk in line with the Word of God, and don't go off of it. And if you give your word for something, fulfill it. Amen? And we want to change the old adage that I don't even hire Christians anymore because they won't ever show up to work. That is a statement that I hear all the time. We want that change because if we go to work or we give our word, we bid a job and we underbid it, we finish it. You understand what I'm saying? That has to be changed. So anyway, most decisions, we need to let integrity of the upright, it says in Proverbs 11:3, integrity will guide the upright. It'll guide you in doing what's right. That's what it'll do. It says this, I'm gonna read to you in a Ephesians, where am I at? Let me get to Ephesians 6. Rendering service readily with good will as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that for whatever good anyone does, he will receive his reward from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. You masters, act on the same principle toward them and give up threatening and using violent and abusive words, knowing that he who is both their master and yours in heaven, and there is no respect of persons, no partiality with him. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him. Draw your strength from him, that strength which his boundless might provides. Put on God's whole armor, the armor of the heavy-armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil. For we are not wrestling with flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against the powers and against master spirits who are in the world rulers, who are the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in heavenly supernatural spheres. When we pray and we stand in the gap and we're fighting spiritual battles, I do have a different view of Obama now. I do believe that he can be changed. Do you understand? I mean, because he is our president. I don't like him as our president. I think he has wrong views and wrong ideologies, and he puts himself up as a Christian, and it's a bad witness. But at the same time, I believe we can stand in the gap and pray for those that are in leadership around the world and expect God to touch their heart, and if he can't change them, he will redirect them according to the Word of God. And so integrity would tell me to stand in the gap. I want to develop more integrity by putting my life on the line and making sure if I say something, I follow through with it, no matter what the outcome seems to be. I just bid a job the other day and I left town. One of my helpers thought he knew more than I did and just went in and did a deal that got our structural engineer involved and everything, and put the window in the wrong place. All it takes is a phone call. Is your pride too much to make a phone call? Do you need to lay down some things so you can walk in obedience? Let me tell you this, if you can walk in integrity before God, you can before men. And somebody was saying, they're going to pay for this, they're going to pay for this, they're going to pay for this. And I said, no. We're going to pay for it. We ain't mentioning it. We paid the price. We made the mistake. Integrity. Don't justify unforgiveness. Don't justify walking awry. Don't justify not walking in it. It's not worth it. Eat your pride and let God minister to you in a special way of integrity. Develop it. Constantly remind yourself that Satan is the father of all lies. He's the one that will try to prompt us to make an exception this time. Oh, it'll be okay that time. No, it will not be if it violates your integrity. Live in love. Live by faith. Put the word first in your life. God will come through for you. Be specific this morning and say, I receive this anointing to walk upright. I receive the anointing of the word that if I say something, I keep my word. Holy Spirit, help me to do that. Help me not to make mistakes. Let me walk upright. Let me be an example in this church and in this area, wherever I go. Let me represent you. Whenever they see me, say, oh, there's that guy thinks he's just like Jesus. Just like Jesus. And whatever we're surrounded by most, this is why you need to watch where you're at and what you surround your life with. But whatever you're surrounded by most will shape your desires. What we consistently look at, do you know what I'm saying? What we consistently look at, put our hope on, put our faith on, will become what we say and do and have. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, while we look not, there's some things you don't need to look at. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal or temporary. And the enemy will try to take a temporary situation and convince you it's eternal and it'll never change. And you got to look at the situation in the face and say, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I rebuke that thought. I walk by faith, not by sight. I believe in the precious power of Almighty God. Holy Spirit, come on the scene. Give me a vision out in the realm of hope, you see. But at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen, the promise of God, they're eternal. You know, integrity is so important. We need to understand that we've got a bad name in certain areas. And we want to change that. We want to change when you're out and people are observing you. Be nice. When you go home, I mean, we have opportunity all the time for me and Patricia to be mean at one another, don't we, honey? Sometimes we are. But we don't want to be. We don't, that ain't our nature. We have the nature of God. We need to make a choice this morning that if when you leave these four walls and you have a tendency to get in your car and you begin to be a yacker and a foul-mouthed person and one that jumps down your wife's throat or your husband, you need to stop it. And you need to walk in integrity no matter what they do. It's not hinged. Your actions is not hinged on another person's actions. But it's hard for us to get that down inside of us. We are always prompted to act because what somebody else did. Let's act because of what Jesus did. Integrity has to come to the body of Christ. We have to be consistent, not with just our words, but our actions and how we love one another. It goes beyond, you've got to be able not to take account of a wrong done to you. Amen. When you do that, it opens all the provision of God to help you. But the minute you take account, the atmosphere is destroyed. Things change. Let's have enough trust in our God that through the month of March, that we watch everything we say. That we begin to form a habit with God that whenever anything comes out of us, it's going to be the agape love. That whatever situation comes up that looks impossible, we command it to leave our life and we call for the provision of God to manifest right there in our life. Let's make March 2012, the last month of this quarter, something for the devil to reckon with. Do not give him an opening. Amen. Walk with integrity toward God. What are you called? Believers? The biggest thing the enemy tries to do is to get us not to hold in esteem that name high enough. If he can make you think it's just kind of a byword, oh, I'm a believer. You are a believer. And your life is to show that when you walk. Amen? So don't listen to the father of lies. John 8:44, he's a liar and a father of all lies. Don't let him subtly deceive you and make you think that you'll make a choice. Don't ever make that choice to go outside the realm of God. All of you have been around long enough, you know what the voice of God is saying. The voice of God is saying, let me flow through your life and let someone see my presence so they will change and turn to me. Amen? The whole crux of integrity is you act like Jesus in here. Act like him out there. Amen? 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 That's the crux of my story this morning. I mean, at one time, in my craziness and ignorance, I'd have probably jumped through the screen at that guy and just got right in the middle of a big brawl. Because he really did try to prompt me. But I didn't. I smiled and turned around and left his porch. It's just one little occasion. That could happen in your own house. It could happen at your job. It might happen at the coffee bar. I hope it doesn't. But somebody's got to break the law of reciprocity. You got to give love back for hate. You got to give a place of peace back for those that spitefully use you. Amen. Integrity of the believer is laid out in Ephesians 5:1, be ye imitators of God.
Amen.
The reason I'm hammering on this, if we get this accomplished, write-ups all over the world is going to say the first local Koinonia group is acting like God. Amen. Amen. First one. We got it. Took 2,000 plus years, but we finally achieved it. We're not taking account of any wrong done to us anymore. We're loving one another. We don't take, if somebody flies off at us, we just give back the love of God. Because you know what? When you're weak, He's strong. Isn't it good? Isn't it good to know you can trust in a power so superior to our natural strength, and that every time He's there, because He never leaves you, never forsakes you, He's always on duty?
That's right.
Amen? So I want to encourage you today. I release the anointing of the living God for you to have a passion to walk so strong this 30 days all the way to the end of March. And if you want to, into April, I'm hoping and I'm believing and I'm praying that it goes the rest of your life.
Amen.
And remember, on Saturday morning, right up in Fellowship Hall, if you want to come and be a part, we're going to be discussing things. We're going to let the Holy Ghost lead the services, the meetings. We're going to believe God to instill faith in everyone there and to get men and women joined together in fellowship more. Amen. I'd like to ask this question. Tyler, is it okay to pick on you, son? Have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you love Him? Tori? Have you accepted Jesus to be your personal Lord and Savior? How did you do that? Did you say, Jesus? Oh, you came to me. She said, no, I came to you. I remember when I laid hands on her for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I remember when several of our kids went over to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. I remember when a lot of you, 44 of you, walked that aisle into that prayer room in 5 weeks just recently and got baptized in the Holy Ghost. 44. I remember that the Lord spoke to me and said, preach the word of God in an uncompromised way, because we're coming into a season that they got to have it. Sister Ruth, have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? Do you believe He's the Son of God? Died for your sins, on the third day rose again. Do you believe that He come to save the world, not to condemn it?
Yes.
Do you believe that anybody that calls on His name will be saved?
Yes.
Is there anybody in this house that's not called on His name? It's that simple. Do you want to be saved today? What are you saved from? You're saved from no relationship with God, hopelessness. And you're saved to knowing God, having eternal life, having a hope, having a peace that only He can give. So I want to ask you, is there anybody in this house that would like to say, I want to call on the name of Jesus this morning? Anybody? Come on, raise your hand. If you've never done that, I want you to do that this morning. Because it's as simple as calling on His name. Anybody? Anybody? God loves you. I read John 3:17 said, I didn't come to condemn anybody. I come to love them and set them free. Anybody need some freedom this morning? Give you a chance. Anybody want freedom today? I'm not really in any hurry, y'all. I just got to thinking, God gave me a vision one time I was in Florida of what hell was like. You know, because there's a lot of religions that teach there's no such thing as a literal hell. I think I'll take God's word on that. And hell was not set up for one human being. Hell was only set up for Lucifer, the one that wanted to replace God, exalt his throne above God's throne. Satan, the deceiver, the liar. Satan, the one that has the eyes of unbelievers blinded, making them think they're okay and they're going straight to hell. Well, he said the gospel is the power of God to knock those blinders off your eyes. That you can receive a glorious Savior that come and not listen anymore to a devil that's trying to make you think he's going to judge you, he's going to condemn you. All he's going to do is give you eternal life and peace and hope like you've never had. That's what he wants. He loves you so much, he wants a relationship. One more time, anybody? 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 I guess I'll see y'all in heaven then. The prerequisite, Paul, is to surrender our will to his. Isn't it? Honey, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Do you believe it's real? Do you believe he's brought life into you? Sam, call on the name of Jesus. Say, Jesus, be my Savior and my Lord. Bam. He is. Have you ever accepted Jesus? Do you want to know peace like you've never known? Everybody does. They just don't know how to get there. If you'll accept him this morning and call on his name, he'll begin to work with you, minister to you, and give you hope like you've never had. I will guarantee that is a Bible promise from me. If you want to do that, say Jesus. Just say it. Jesus, be my Savior and be my Lord. Right now, I accept you. Help me through this life. I surrender to you. In Jesus' name, amen. What about you, darling? Have you, you've accepted Jesus? Say, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. I thank you. Give me life and abundant life. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, y'all both, you gave your heart to the Lord, didn't you, recently? Why don't you just reaffirm, say, Jesus, you're my Savior. I acknowledge that. Right now, give me peace, give me hope, in Jesus' name, amen. Hold on just a second. Good morning. Love you.
I have given my life to the Lord, and Some of you who don't know me don't know where I've been, don't know how far I went, and how grateful I am to be here with you guys, to be accepted by all of you. And these guys need to be telling us, warning us when they're going to sing Amazing Grace, because I always cry, because the grace of the Lord has saved me. I'm a complete wretched soul. Was. I am covered in the blood of the Lamb, and the Lord is good. The Lord is gracious. And for those of you who don't know, I was lost. I was a drug addict. I was married to the drug dealer. I was an alcoholic for many years, and I have been blessed of God. I have been set free.
Amen.
And I am so glad that you guys, I am so glad that Jeanette and Bruce have a great Sunday morning class. Some of you should come join us. And this is an advertisement. And I love these people.
I love you.
Thank you.
You know, it's amazing that she's half the woman she used to be. That's what Bruce's class does for you. And her husband's coming down the pike. Bruce, did y'all know Bruce lost 90 pounds?
I only lost 38.
You did? She's lost 38. Go in that class. I love you, Sharon. God bless you. God bless you. All Patricia and I, as your senior pastors, want is for you to walk in peace and victory all the days of your life. Bring glory to God by producing fruit. And as you do, everyone around you will be affected for the kingdom. Let's have communion. Yes, honey. Speak loud.